From the first book of Maccabees. As King Antiochus was traveling the inland provinces, he heard that in Persia there was a city called Elymais, famous for its wealth in silver and gold, and that its temple was very rich, containing gold helmets, breastplates, and weapons left there by Alexander, son of Philip, king of Macedon, the first king of the Greeks. He went, therefore, and tried to capture and pillage the city. But he could not do so, because his plan became known to the people of the city, who rose up in battle against him. So he retreated and in great dismay withdrew from there to return to Babylon. While he was in Persia, a messenger brought him news that the armies sent into the land of Judah had been put to flight, that Lysias had gone at first with a strong army and been driven back by the children of Israel, that they had grown strong by reason of the arms, men, and abundant possessions taken from the armies they had destroyed, that they had pulled down the abomination which he had built upon the altar in Jerusalem, and that they had surrounded with high walls both the sanctuary, as it had been before, and his city of Beth-Zur. When the king heard this news, he was struck with fear and very much shaken. Sick with grief because his designs had failed, he took to his bed. There he remained many days, overwhelmed with sorrow, for he knew he was going to die. So he called in all his friends and said to them, "Sleep has departed from my eyes, for my heart is sinking with anxiety. I said to myself, 'Into what tribulation have I come, and in what floods of sorrow am I now?' Yet I was kindly and beloved in my rule. But I now recall the evils I did in Jerusalem, when I carried away all the vessels of gold and silver that were in it, and for no cause gave orders that the inhabitants of Judah be destroyed. I know that this is why these evils have overtaken me, and now I am dying in bitter grief in a foreign land." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord. I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will declare all your wondrous deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, Most High. I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord. Because my enemies are turned back, overthrown and destroyed before you, you rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. Their name you blotted out forever and ever. I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord. The nations are sunk in the pit they have made. In the snare they set, their foot is caught. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, nor shall the hope of the afflicted forever perish. I will rejoice in your salvation, O Lord. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Some Sadducees, those who deny that there is a resurrection, came forward and put this question to Jesus, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us, 'If someone's brother dies, leaving a wife but no child, his brother must take the wife and raise up descendants for his brother.' Now there were seven brothers. The first married a woman but died childless. Then the second and the third married her, and likewise all the seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. Now, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be? For all seven had been married to her." Jesus said to them, "The children of this age marry and remarry. But those who are deemed worthy to attain to the coming age and to the resurrection of the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. They can no longer die, for they are like angels, and they are the children of God, because they are the ones who will rise. That the dead will rise, even Moses made known in the passage about the bush, when he called Lord the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And he is not God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive. Some of the scribes said in reply, Teacher, you have answered well. And they no longer dared to ask him anything. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We are on the road to heaven. We are called to be there. The purpose of this life is to love and serve the God that we come to know because he reveals himself to us, to be happy with him forever in heaven. Heaven is our destiny, and we will be in heaven much longer, very, very quickly, than we had ever been on earth. Eternity, forever, no end. That's got to be a constant subject of our reflection and meditation. No end to the joy, the victory, the triumph over everything that is evil, the separation, the sorrow, the tears, the fear of death, all of that will be gone. We will have each other, we will have God, we will have everything good. Not to a limited degree like we have in this world, not to a compromised degree like we have in this life, not all mixed in with evil like we have now, where Jesus used the parable of the weeds and the wheat growing together. Yes, they grow together, they're all intertwined, good and evil, belief and unbelief, all intertwined in this world, and in constant conflict and struggle that causes us constant anxiety and grief. Not in heaven. We are on the road there, and we must embrace it now in order to have it after death. It's not something that we decide to take hold of after death or that we just passively receive after we die. Somebody I was counseling one time said, well, I'll worry when I die about whether I'm going to heaven then. And I said, no, we take hold of heaven after we die if we take hold of it while we live. This is the key thing that our Lord is asking us to do in this life, to take hold of the life that is eternal. And we take hold of it by faith, by baptism, by living as followers of Christ. We live out our vocation to grow in that holiness and to grow in that life that, yes, will blossom in its fullness after we die, will, after the final judgment, be indeed purified and separated forever from the evil, the weeds and the wheat finally being separated one from the other. But we have to take hold of it now. We can't leave the question or postpone the question, as this person was saying to me, until later. Now, Jesus got into a dispute here in this passage we read from the Gospel of Luke. There were the Sadducees that did not believe in the resurrection or in spirits or in angels, and there were the Pharisees who believed in all of those things. And this is why the Sadducees, Jesus was teaching about the resurrection, and this is why the Sadducees were challenging him about it. When we say life eternal, we don't just mean that our soul lives on. We know that the soul in and of itself is immortal. The body, on the other hand, is subject to mortality. But that's because of sin. We are human beings. As human beings, we are a unity of body and soul. So when God saves us and when God calls us to live forever, he calls us to live forever as human beings. So death is not you going out of existence. Death is the separation of your body from your soul. And that's why the body disintegrates. You live on in your soul, but a human being is a body and soul combination. So you will be a living human soul, but you will also receive your body back again in the resurrection. The resurrection of the body. We believe in the resurrection of the body. It is a dogma of our faith. Christ taught it. The church teaches it definitively. In order to be a Christian, one must hold to that belief that we will indeed, again, I say be, not just receive, because the body is not something we have. It's not a thing at all. It's us. The body's not a thing we have. The body is an aspect of who we are. So we indeed will live again in the body after the resurrection. And it will be the same body, although it will be set free from any kind of weakness, sickness, disease. No matter what happens to our physical body after we die, God will raise it and restore it. But because he will raise it and restore it, because it is destined for life eternal, we treat the body with respect. That's why at a funeral you see the priest incensing the body. That's why we reverently bury the body. And in the case of someone who is cremated, when there are justifying reasons for that, again, those remains are treated with great respect because we remember this is destined to resurrection. Now, in the resurrection, Jesus says here, there will not be marriage. Well, that's interesting. Now, that doesn't mean we won't see our spouse. If you're married, obviously, both you and your spouse want to be saved. You want one another to be saved. And presuming that you are saved, yes, indeed, you will know and be with each other. Some people ask, well, will we know each other in heaven? Well, of course, that's one of the great joys that God intends to give us forever. Being with one another, being with him, yes, we'll see him face to face. But that includes being with one another. Of course, we will know each other in heaven. You will have your spouse, you will know your spouse, but there will not be marriage. Why? Because marriage will be fulfilled. Understand what I'm saying. Marriage, as one of the greatest blessings in this life, a relationship of such deep intimacy, spiritual and physical, a relationship that mirrors God in as much as it gives new life, marriage will have fulfilled its purpose, which is to be a sign of the marriage between Christ and his church, the marriage between God and his people, which likewise bears fruit in the birth of many people through acceptance of the word by faith and baptism, acceptance of that life eternal that God gives. And the fact that he gives it, by the way, through his sacraments is why a priest is called father, because we do beget life. It's spiritual life. But marriage will have fulfilled its purpose. Marriage is pointing to this relationship between God and his people, this consummation of the love that God has for his people. Even in the Old Testament, and through Isaiah, God said, your maker has become your husband. So God sets up this image that he loves us so much, he wants to marry us as his people. And Christ, of course, speaks about the bridegroom himself as the bridegroom. Paul develops this teaching very beautifully, especially in Ephesians, where he says that Christ is the spouse of the church. And we see it at the very end of the Bible, the Spirit and the bride being the church, say, come, come, Lord Jesus, come, spouse. This is the marriage. And in heaven, it's culminated. And we're with God and we see him face to face and we're as fully in union with him as we can possibly be. That's what marriage was pointing to. It's not that we won't be with one another. You'll be with your spouse. We'll all be together in perfect love. The great love that you who are married experience with one another is just a dim foreshadowing of the intensity and joy of the love in heaven. And brothers and sisters, look at the beautiful analogy Jesus makes, the argument he makes here in Luke 20 about the reality of the resurrection. Scripture says that God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses has said that. Now, what the argument that Jesus is making here is this. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob have died. So if God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, how can they be dead in the sense of not existing? How can that be if he is still their God? Moses is calling him their God today. God is the God of the living. He is the living God. So if Moses says he's the God of three people who have already died, well, then death doesn't have the final word, does it? God is a God of the living. So if he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they're living. They're alive. There is life after death. This is the argument Jesus himself is making from the scriptures. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Brothers and sisters, people have many questions about heaven. It's a beautiful topic to think about. I've given you some thoughts about it here. But I want to give you a little norm of interpretation, a little way that you can answer in advance the questions that you may have about heaven. And it comes from St. Augustine, actually. He says, take away corruption and add what you will. Think about it this way. Heaven is everything good because it's union with God. It's everything good to an infinite degree. It's full union with God. Anything good, anything you hope you're going to have in heaven, anything you wonder if you're going to have it in heaven because you love it so much and it brings you so much joy, think of it this way. Why is it good in the first place? Why does it bring you so much joy? Because it's of God. It's a reflection. Everything, like I said just now about marriage and married love, everything that brings you such joy, pleasure, that is so meaningful and precious to you in this life is meaningful, is pleasurable, is precious because of God. But it's yet just a dim reflection of God. The greatest of joys, the greatest of possessions in this life, the greatest of relationships, the greatest happiness, the greatest satisfaction, the exaltation of spirit is all just a dim reflection of all those things which will be in their infinite degree in God, and we will see him face to face, and we'll be like under a waterfall, where here we may have taken a drink of some of the joys. There we will be immersed in an ocean, waterfall, the fullness forever of everything that's good. So Augustine says, well, take away corruption, and add what you will. It's the fullness of everything that is good. And that's how you can answer the questions you may have about heaven. Will there be this? Will there be that? Will I have this joy? Will I have that joy? There is no joy you will lack. Will I see that person? Will I see this person? There is no relationship, no joy you will miss. It's the fullness of eternal joy. Let us strive to grasp that salvation. Let us look forward to it. But let that looking forward make us grasp it all the more securely here on earth by a life of faith and of faithfulness to the life of God himself. That's what heaven is, the life of God himself. He's living in us, he's living among us, he's uniting us, he's blessing us, he's giving us salvation. Amen.